Senator from Utah.
Mr. President, I rise today to talk about an issue that will have serious negative consequences on the lives and livelihoods of millions of Americans and threaten our already muddled and beleaguered health care system. Ever since the partisan and rushed passage of the so-called Affordable Care Act, I've come to the floor dozens of times to shine a light on the problems associated with this law and to call for a swift repeal and replacement. I've not been alone. Many of my colleagues have been working to make this case as well. Truth be told, this hasn't been an altogether difficult case to make. And indeed, the data have repeatedly shown that Obamacare, despite the many claims of its proponents, simply is not working. We've seen more evidence of this in just the past few days. For example, in a recent New York Times article, we all read about the dramatic proposed increases in health insurance premiums due to Obamacare's expensive mandates and regulations. Now, many plans are proposing rate increases that average 23% in Illinois, 25% in North Carolina, 31% in Oklahoma, 36% in Tennessee, and 54% in Minnesota. Mr. President, I don't know about you, but my constituents find this unnerving. After all, one of the president's chief justifications for his health care law was that it would actually bring down the cost of health care. Once again, we're seeing that this was just another one of the many empty Obamacare promises. But even more frightening than these proposed rate increases are the root causes of the increases. In the recent New York Times article, Nathan T. Johns, the chief financial officer of Arches Health Plan, which operates in my home state of Utah, was quoted as saying, quote, "Our enrollees generated 24% more claims than we thought they would when we set our 2014 rates," unquote. This, according to Mr. Johns, led to a collection of just under $40 million in premiums, while the company had to pay out more than $56 million in claims for 2014. As a result, Arches Health Plan has proposed rate increases averaging 45% for 2016 in order to remain viable. Now, I know this is not all, this was not at all the intention of my Democrat colleagues who voted for this bill. But it is because of this and a myriad of other unintended consequences that Obamacare has consistently polled below 50% approval since the day it was signed into law. Indeed, according to a compilation by Real Clear Politics of the 405 polls collected since the law passed in March of 2010, 391 reported a majority of Americans opposing or having negative views towards Obamacare. Unfortunately, President Obama seems to be disconnected from this reality. In a recent trip to Tennessee, the president called for consumers to put pressure on state insurance regulators to scrutinize the proposed rate increases. He then suggested that if commissioners do their job and actively review the rates, his, quote, expectation is that they'll come in significantly lower than what's being requested, unquote. But as Roy Vaughn, the vice president of the Tennessee Blue Cross Plan, stated, quote, "There's not a lot of mystery to it. We lost a significant amount of money in the marketplace, $141 million, because we were not very accurate in predicting the utilization of health care," unquote. Yet President Obama fails to grasp the simple mathematics of the problem, and he's not alone. In response to the president's call for scrutiny, the Tennessee insurance commissioner was quoted as saying she would ask, quote, "hard questions of companies we regulate to protect consumers," unquote. Forgive me, Mr. President, but I fail to understand what hard questions there are to ask. If I own a business that takes in $100 million in revenue but pays out $120 million in expenses, I won't be solvent for very long. What is perhaps most disconcerting to me in all of this are the responses these patients get from officials in the Obama administration. For example, in response to concerns about these premium hikes, Health and Human Services Secretary Burwell recently argued that patients shouldn't worry because there are tax subsidies available to help cover the costs. She also said that they could simply shop for cheaper plans on the exchanges during the next open enrollment period. Of course, in a world where insurance plans across the country are requesting rate increases of 20, 30, 40, or even 50% or more, one has to wonder just how many cheaper plans will be available and how many sacrifices patients will have to make in their care in order to get significant savings. Mr. President, while many seem to believe that the Affordable Care Act received a reprieve from the Supreme Court, I think we are actually witnessing the downward spiral of Obamacare. And I cannot help but question what supposed solutions my friends on the other side of the aisle will come up with next. Anyone who's being honest and who is listening to the American people should recognize that Obamacare needs to be replaced with real, patient-centered reforms that are designed not to control the marketplace, but to actually reduce the costs for hardworking patients and taxpayers. I'm a co-author of such a plan, which we've called the Patient Care Act. This legislative proposal, which I've put forward along with Senator Burr and Chairman Fred Upton in the House, will reduce the cost of health care in this country without all the expensive mandates and regulations that are causing these major increases in health insurance premiums. I've talked about our proposal many times here on the floor, and I will continue to do so. I know there are other ideas out there, and I think we should consider and evaluate those as well. Put simply, I am willing to work with anyone on either side of the aisle to fix our nation's health care system and to protect the American people from the negative consequences of this misguided law. My hope, Mr. President, is that more of our colleagues on the other side will eventually see what the majority of American people have seen for more than 5 years now. The problems with Obamacare are not minor flaws that can be fixed with a little regulatory tinkering. They are fundamental flaws. The only answer is real reform, which addresses the skyrocketing costs of health care in America. With that, Mr. President, you can see that I'm very, very concerned about Obamacare and the fact that it's breaking America. Not working, costs are going up on a rapid basis, people are not being well served. The emergency rooms, which were supposed to be spared from all this, are just full of Medicaid and Medicare patients who cannot find doctors now. I mean, doctors are leaving the profession because of Obamacare in large measure. And we can't get help to those who really need the help because of the many restrictions in Obamacare. All I can say, the sooner or later, we've got to get off our high horse and look at this and look at it in a very effective, nonpartisan way and either change it or get rid of it and replace it with something that will work much better and will be something the American people can live with. There were approximately 35 million people who did not have health insurance before Obamacare. That was a big issue. The president has cited that many times. Guess how many don't have insurance now with Obamacare? About 30, 35 million people. So has this just been a big boondoggle? So the president can take credit for something that doesn't work? Or are we going to do the thing that we all should as members of Congress in the best interest of our citizens, change this bill and get one that really does work? With that, Mr. President, I suggest the absence of a quorum.